just if you guys have a chance, just go ahead and write down your name. Students, please write down your name too. But there's some pens and stuff on the desk that you guys can keep. I also have shopping bags, gym bags, or anything else you guys want. Feel free to take one with you. I don't need them. I'm hopefully getting a whole slew of stuff from colleges again this year once I get stuff sent off to them. But that's all for you guys to take if you want. And I got a bunch more pins if you guys are like pin crazy or lose them. Up here too, if you guys didn't get them when you walked in, you don't have to grab them right now. I'm not going to refer to them right away. But there are three packets. One of them is a course progression. That's kind of a, for you guys are pretty much set, I think. But for younger kids, this kind of compares high school graduation to two-year and four-year college requirements in a little bit easier manner than what we used to have. There's a smaller sheet here that talks about two-year college requirements, and there's just a bunch of resources I printed off and stuck in a packet for you. There's also a four-year college packet. This one's about, I don't know, 30 or 40 pages double-sided, so it's got a lot of good information in case you want to take that home with you. In addition to all that, on the website, under the counseling menu, there's a link, and maybe I might show you at the very end. Once I get out of the presentation, I can screencast where it's at. But on the website, if you haven't checked it out, there's under the counseling menu, there's a link that says, I keep on forgetting the exact word, it's like resources, handbooks, and grade level resource folders or something like that. That has a bunch of information. One, it's got handbooks. I have two handbooks. I have a community college handbook that has additional information in addition to this other packet, as well as a four-year college advising handbook. Okay, that handbook's about 60 to 80 pages long. Okay, it's got a ton of information, so I'd encourage you, I don't expect you guys to like memorize it front to back, but it would be something good to have as a reference guide as you go through. Maybe comb through it, just see what's in there so you can go back to it and use it as a resource later when you're in the middle of application season. So I want to let you guys know about that. Pretty sure most of you guys already know my contact information. I'm very happy you guys are my first full set of kids going through the high school, so it's very exciting for me. So we'll see. We'll see what happens in June. I don't know. Could be good or bad. But we'll kind of talk about a whole bunch of stuff. I'll kind of skip through the agenda. It's pretty. Well, we'll basically look at some data and stats, some information about all the different kind of college applications that you might be encountering, as well as some kind of how-tos and what to expect about what the process here is here at North Tahoe High School. And we'll try to do it as quickly as possible, but covering as much information as we need to. Don't be afraid to stop me and ask questions if you have any. The last thing I'll talk about for kind of housekeeping things. On your desk, too, in addition to the pens, are some little post-it notes. On the blackboard up there, I have two little boxes that you can feel free to stand up in the middle of the presentation. Maybe you have a more personal question, not like when will I get a date or something like that, but you know, something that's maybe not, you know, very specific to your student or something like that you'd like me to answer, but it might not be the best fit for tonight. Feel free to jot it down or just say email me, or you can shoot me an email and you can stick it up there or anything you want me to answer as a whole group. At the end, I'll pull some questions out there, as well as any ideas, thoughts, or feedback. Like, I'm always interested in making this better, and you know, overall the counseling program. College advising, or just even tonight's talk. Okay, so feel free to get up and put those things up there at any time. This has a link. If you guys are like super savvy, you can use a little QR code, but I probably won't leave it up there that long. But again, this link is to those resource folders, as well as a link to this presentation PDF. Okay, so this is a PDF in that grade level resource folder that you can find underneath the counseling menu on the website. All right. It's a shared Dropbox folder, and there's a bunch of other resources in that Dropbox folder as well. All right? Anybody else need me to stay up here longer? Blanca?
I'm going to see if it works. Too far.
All right, it might be too far. But again, you can find it on the website. All right, so just quickly, we might have touched on this, but I want to make sure that we understand our norms and our parent expectations, student expectations, and school expectations about the college application process. And I do apologize, that's small. I see some people squinting. So, parents, when you guys are doing this, how many of you guys are first-time college application people? First-time college goers. Second time? Or third or more? Okay. So, you first times look around and find the second times or third times and make friends with them, invite them over for dinner, bring a bottle of wine, learn from their experience. Okay. Their experience is valid and valuable. Okay. So, it's very good experience. They might not be the experts. I'm not even an expert, even though to some people I might be. There are so many things to know about college admissions and applications. And there's not really a 100% right answer most of the time. It's usually a process. Okay, but you guys are a very important part of the process. However, you guys are not driving the process. You might feel like it sometimes because your kid's not really driving it either, but you guys are the ones that really are there as the cheerleader and the supporting role. Okay, and that's kind of the picture I want you to have in your head. If you guys start playing the race car driver of, we're going to go here, there, and the other place, and the kid's like, whatever, Mom, I don't want to do this, they're going to still be saying that when they get to that place that they don't actually want to go. Okay, so I've seen it happen where students are not really driven to be successful or want to pursue like a four-year college degree. They're like, Mom, I just want to go to a two-year college. That's what I feel comfortable with. And they kind of get pushed in possibly to that four-year college world, and they're unhappy and typically, in many cases, unsuccessful because they're kind of setting themselves up for the certain type of environment that they're looking for. So work with your student. You're supposed to be there as kind of a support and guide, but let them drive. Let them share their expertise and what they know about themselves. It's a very emotional year as well, so try to separate all the kind of like logistical pieces and kind of the pieces about, okay, here's a deadline, you know, that kind of stuff from the emotional side. Okay, your baby's going to be leaving pretty soon, or your second baby, or your third baby. Okay, pretty soon that's going to happen, and it's going to become an emotional process, both sad and very happy. Okay, but you have to prepare yourself for that. But when you're talking about college admissions, it's something that you have to prepare yourself for and try to separate those as much as possible. You know, it's kind of like, you know, being an EMT worker or something like that. You have some very, very emotional times at work, but you try to separate what's work and then from your home life. And that's how it kind of makes it manageable. Same thing with college admissions. Again, you're not expected, nor should you do any of the work. The work that you should be doing as parents is going to be things like helping the student and doing the FAFSA. Okay, so the FAFSA will be one piece that will be big in your plate. That's the free application for federal student aid. I'll talk a little bit more about financial aid in a little bit. But that is one piece that students will be depending definitely on you for, because that's going to be using your taxes. It's going to be how they're going to pay for college. However, when you're talking about essays, personal statements, applications, you guys should almost not even touch it until the student has gone all the way through it. Okay? If you're on there kind of nitpicking their essay before they've kind of even had a chance to fix it and finish it, guess who's coming across in that essay? Not your student, you. Okay, and who's going to college? Your student. Okay, so make sure, my advice is always give your student a chance to at least write a rough draft. Have them give you what they think they're gonna answer it with. And I require the same thing. And then take that and look at that from a parent perspective and say, hey, this is really good. What if we kind of like, if you just changed a few of these words, what if we came at it from a little bit different angle, but I like the place that you're coming from? And that's kind of the approach that I use too. If I kind of get in there, or an English teacher gets in there and really changes a bunch of stuff, the colleges don't want to see what I have to say. They want to see what the student has to say. So make sure that you guys are giving them the space to kind of be creative themselves in these application processes, but definitely check it over. Okay, always check essays. I encourage at least 3 checks, okay, minimum. Have an English teacher check it, have me check it, or another college counselor check it, and have you check it. Okay, those 3 checklists should be on your list for every essay you're going to write. Why? Because your English teacher is going to get all those grammatical, syntax, you know, grammar, all that stuff. That's not me. I can't do that. Spell check is about as far as I go. I'll check to make sure that, yeah, this is going to probably hit well with that college person that's going to be reading it. Is this going to be a good place to come from? Maybe there's something stronger we can add. Maybe change a few words that are going to bring some more attention to yourself and your qualities that you're bringing to the school. And then you guys, as a parent, you know your child better than anybody. So you guys are able to talk to them and say, hey, you know, what about this other experience that you had? Like, did you remember that? And not pushing it on them like this is like what you need to write about, but just possibly there might be something else that they might not remember or maybe didn't think about writing about. And then set aside time. Okay, it's very important, just like a meeting, going to a doctor, going to a dentist, set aside some specific time to start talking about college or continue talking about college in a realistic fashion, because it's going to come quick. So whether that's, hey, every Tuesday night we're going to go out and we're going to get an ice cream and we're going to sit down in the ice cream parlor, we're going to bring our computers, we're going to talk college for 30 or 45 minutes. Have a date. You know, go out with your daughter or your son and take them out and talk about what's next. Okay, so that's always a good idea. Students, don't pay attention when you're looking at college Do not just look at the name. Do not just look at the location. Okay, that's the biggest piece of advice that I can give you. Is if you're applying to a college because it's got the UC name in it, or you're applying to college because it's at the beach, then I'm saying you might have a great time, but you might be missing out on something even better. Okay, so when I'm advising you guys, I want you guys to think outside the box. Don't look for just the Toyotas, Chevys, Fords. Look for the little Opals and look for like the, you know, TDRs and stuff like that. These other kind of more obscure but still great quality colleges that are out there that might be a great fit for you. That doesn't mean don't consider those other schools. Don't think about applying to them, but don't limit your options. Okay, so that's one thing for you guys. Keeping organized this year is going to be super crucial. If you guys are not organized, it's going to be a very painful and a not fun year. So if you guys have binders, if you guys have Google calendars, use them. Okay, and don't use it for a week and then stop using it. Because it's going to be a year of deadlines, it's going to be a year of following up paperwork, keeping track of things. And if you're organized, it's going to make your year so much more fun. And like I said this morning, this year can be either very not fun, or it can be very, very much fun. Okay, I'm hoping for the lot of fun side. But there will be a lot of stress. Deadlines, like I said, are very important. Please make sure that you're keeping track of them. Add every deadline to a calendar. Create reminders. One deadline that I will tell you that I told you guys this morning. UCSU applications, when are they due? November 30th. Okay. November 30th, when does that fall? Thanksgiving break. Okay. So, one piece to think about is, if you are having any trouble with filling out your UC or CSU application, make sure that you come and see me and get help before we leave for Thanksgiving break. Please do not all come on Tuesday afternoon, though. Because I'm leaving for Thanksgiving break, too. Typically, I am not very available. I can tell you this Thanksgiving break in particular, I will be very unavailable because I'm at two weddings, at a family thing, and like super busy with my own kind of family stuff. So I probably will not be able to answer many questions over email. Usually I try to, but this Thanksgiving will be pretty challenging to catch me. So just think about that. Add that to your calendar. Maybe set an earlier reminder, hey, make sure my stuff's ready the week before Thanksgiving. All right? And then apply broadly, but not so broadly that you spend a lot of money and a lot of time wasting energy and effort filling out applications and writing essays. Okay? The magic number that I try to give is between 6 and 10. All right? 1 and 2, too few. Okay? People get denied from colleges all over the board for any given reason. You can be a straight A, 4.5 GPA student, perfect score in the SAT, and still be denied to college. Okay? So nothing is a safe bet in college admissions. When you guys are applying, that 6 to 10 rule is typically going to be broken down into like two reach schools, meaning two schools that are going to be challenging for anybody. Okay, you might have a 3.8 GPA, and a reach school for you could be, you know, UC Berkeley, UCLA. All right? It's going to be a little challenging to get into that school with a 3.7, 3.8 GPA sometimes. You know, there's different factors that weigh in, but that could possibly be a reach school. It's definitely not safe. You might have some more better fit schools. That might be Long Beach, San Francisco State, that kind of school for a student kind of with that 3.8 GPA range. And then some more safer, so a little safer schools. You might look at like UC Merced, UC Santa Cruz maybe. Sacramento State is a very safe school for everybody in our area. Why? Because Sacramento State is what they call our regional campus. And basically, if you apply to Sacramento State and have met all of your A through G requirements and have a 3.0 or above, you're essentially guaranteed admissions to Sacramento State. Okay? So that's something just to keep in the back of your mind. If you're looking for a safe school, Sacramento State's going to probably be about as safe as it's going to get, other than Montana State. Montana State's pretty safe. Any questions about that so far? Oh, I forgot that was there. But again, last point reminded me, all these different schools that you apply to, you should be happy going to. Because if there's one school on your list that you are not going to be happy to be there for 4 or 5 years, that's the one school that you're going to get admitted to. And you're going to have to go there and make some other choices. Okay, so make sure that you've done your research, that all the schools you'd be very happy to go with. Obviously, you'll have first choice and kind of a priority list. But you would not want to be somewhere that you're not going to be happy being. All right. So our different kind of options for next year. This kind of probably is a little bit of review, but I want to make sure everyone's clear. So we have our four-year colleges and universities. And college and university is used interchangeably, just so you know. They're relatively used, like, synonymous this day and age. But there's several different systems that we're most familiar with. We've got the University of California system, the UC system, that's the 9 campuses. CSUs or California State Schools, that's 23 campuses around the state. There's a bunch of private schools. I don't know the exact number in California, but there's a whole ton. And those also extend across the United States, multiple thousands of private schools out there and other state systems that you can look into. I know a lot of people consider like Utah schools, a lot of some of the East Coast schools for skiing. So there's a lot of different opportunities out there for you to take advantage of. The one thing to keep in mind when you're looking at private schools and out-of-state schools is tuition. Okay, when you're looking at out-of-state schools and tuition, you're not looking at in-state. You're looking at out-of-state, which is typically comparable or even more. For example, if you're looking at like University of Michigan, that's going to be more than many private states or private school tuition for their out-of-state. So just keep that in mind. We're looking at out-of-state tuition, and not just 1 year, 4 to 5 years. Okay, that's very important. Some people look at the cost of attendance. They're like, oh, I can do $25,000 a year. I got that saved up. But then you use that big check in your bank, and that's just 1 year. How are you going to do that the rest of the year? Okay, or the rest of the 4 or 5 years? And most of the time, it's typically turning into a 5-year bachelor's degree in many, many schools, especially in the state systems here. There's also the community college world. Okay, we have, I think it's 112, if my memory serves right, in the state of California. And they're designed as kind of a regional service for students. Most of the time, students are not going to necessarily leave the area to go to community college. Sometimes you'll see that. However, that's not a money-saving opportunity. Okay, you're not going to save a bunch of money if you go down to Santa Barbara and go to Santa Barbara City College. You probably will spend about the same as you'd spend to go to most state schools with financial aid included. Okay, so it's not always the least expensive option, especially if you're on the lower income side. Going to a 4-year college could actually be less expensive than going to a 2-year college in kind of like a similar type of field, okay? Because you might actually get more money from the federal government because of your income, and less money because you get less if you're going to a community college, so it caps out lower. There's also trade or vocational schools. That's going to be like Universal Technical Institute, Wyotech, Marinello Beauty School, trying to think of the cooking school, you know, Culinary Institute of America. Those types of schools are all what we would call trade or vocational schools. And those schools are preparing for a trade, some sort of certification process, passing certain types of tests to be able to work in certain fields. Okay, so those are all the different options we have available. A couple that are not up there that you might be considering would be things like gap years. Okay, who knows what a gap year is? Okay, gap years have become kind of popular in the last couple of years, I feel like. Gap years are essentially going to be a year in between going to college or whatever your next education or employment opportunity is going to be, and either traveling, even though most of the time gap years are geared more towards philanthropic type of activities. You're going to go volunteer with Rotary in Argentina and, you know, teach kids English or rebuild houses. Okay, those are all gap years. Some people take it to travel, and that's not really time super well spent. I enjoy traveling, but spending a year traveling does not always pay off in the long run. But many times, taking a gap year and working in these kind of like volunteer opportunities can. Okay, so that's one opportunity. You can work, you can live at home, bum off your parents. Those are all opportunities that you can have. However, I think that these main ones up there are gonna be probably what most people will do and probably the most recommended options, because this is what's going to pay off for your future. All right, so let's jump into the different systems, and we'll kind of go through some of this quick, because I think most of you guys were here and kind of know some of this stuff, but I will touch on the little basic pieces that we'll go over. University of California, so that's a UC system with 9 different campuses. 8 different campuses. The application period is different than when it's actually open. So the application is actually already available to start filling out. You can get all the way up to when you need to pay, I think, and like hit the submit button and be done now. So you can go online and complete the application now for all the UC campuses. However, you can only hit that submit button and pay between the dates of November 1st and November 30th. So you have 1 month to actually submit. Some people make the mistake of actually waiting until that month to submit. I would suggest getting started now with anything you can get started with, because things start piling up very quickly, as well as homework and projects and community service and all the other sporting events that you got going on. It's an all-online application. They don't have a paper application available. So you go online to their website. If you just Google UC application fall 2016, it'll pop up there. You only need one app. You fill out one application for each for all the campuses. However, you do have to individually select which campuses you would like to apply to. Pretty much, you fill out the application. You say which ones do I want to send it to, and it will spit out the application to all the campuses, and you pay the one fee per campus. So it's going to be $70 times however many UC campuses that you apply to. There are fee waivers available if you qualify. Typically, qualification for fee waivers is going to be similar to the qualification for free and reduced lunch at school. So if you qualify for that at school, typically you will qualify for any fee waivers on the SAT, the ACT, college applications, but that clears up the four applications. Finally, test scores. All the test scores are going to be needed to be ordered directly from the testing agency itself. We do not keep it. We get reports back, and we have information on your test scores, but they all need to be official test scores that go to schools. Okay, so you're gonna have to order a bunch of different test scores, probably from the ACT and or the SAT directly. So you do that through where you signed up for the SAT or through your ACT portal, and if you just Google order SAT scores, it should land you right probably on the first link where you need to go. However, with the UC system, all you need to do, if you're applying to like three UCs, you don't need to order three different test reports. Order one, all eight campuses will then share that information. So don't waste another 20 or 30 bucks ordering three different test scores. But just make sure that you do actually order them. So a few steps, and I don't do this to scare you at all. I do this to give you kind of a realistic perspective for the UCs. And this is for the class of last year's graduating class, application class. But you can kind of see the different rankings. And some of these UCs are getting up there to almost Ivy level. Okay, they're getting up to the very highly competitive kind of class of schools. You look at Berkeley, they had almost 79,000 people apply last year alone. Okay, 79,000, they admitted 13,000 of those 79,000. Okay, who do you think those 79,000 people were when they were applying? They were all probably, many of them were valedictorians. Many of them were all very highly athletic. Many of them were straight-A students, very well, spoken, very well written, doing great on the SATs. So I don't mean that to scare you. I mean that to show you that even those people that are all kind of in that boat still get denied from schools. Even schools like UC Berkeley, which is a great school, but it's a state school. You typically think state schools as being kind of more open and flexible and, more accepting of students. But, UCLA, UC Berkeley are kind of more on that extreme of things. But you start looking at places like UC Merced. Granted, Merced is probably not the first choice of places to live for college, or for any purpose, probably. I grew up in the Valley, I can say that. But it is a great UC campus. Okay, so I'll just talk a little bit about the other side of UC Spectrum. It's a brand new campus. I think it's built in the last 15 years, so it's very, very, very new and very cutting edge, and they have a lot of great programs. So if you're maybe thinking like, hey, I'd like the caliber of education that a UC program would give me, look at UC Merced. Okay, the likelihood of getting in there is much, much higher than getting into some of the other ones. But even places like, Davis, Irvine, those are places you don't just walk into either. 31% means they're every two out of three students are being denied. Okay, so just keep that in mind. Telling you this because I want you to have a realistic approach to your college applications. That even if you are that all-star student, it doesn't mean that you're always going to get into any school that you want. So just have that perspective going in so that you're not totally disappointed if you get that letter back that's, sorry, good luck in your future endeavors. But I'm sure hoping that we kind of balance your application list so that doesn't happen. We don't want all Berkeleys on there because then we might. Statistically, we are more likely to get denies than acceptances. So finally, kind of just some logistics about the University of California system. Okay, you do not need letters of recommendation for the University of California application. Basically, all you're going to need is a copy of your transcript. You'll fill in the information about your classes, a bunch of personal information about your address, phone number, all that stuff. You'll enter two personal statement answers. a little bit, you have a little bit of space to write about extracurricular activities and list extracurriculars and any community service that you feel like stands out. I think it's like 5 spaces. And that's it. That's what they're using to determine your admissions on. So it's a little scary, because that's not a lot. However, I'll show you a slide in just a second about what they actually consider when they're doing their reviews. And every campus is different. Okay, so the UCs doesn't have like this overarching umbrella approach to admissions. They break it down by campus. So every campus is going to set their different priorities of what they're looking for an applicant class. Berkeley's going to look for something completely different than Davis, and so on and so forth. Your eligibility is based on your A through G coursework. That's all those classes you've been taking for college prep purposes. Your GPA, and it's important because it's not your overall GPA, it's not even your total GPA. Do you guys know what, do you want me to talk a little bit about, real quickly, about the GPA? Do most people understand the differences? Okay. So if you guys have questions about that, either email me and I can send you an explanation, or we can sit down and talk. Because there are some very distinct differences. However, the one that they're going to be looking at most closely, we don't even actually have it accurate on our transcripts probably, is that 10 through 12 weighted GPA. When you're looking on the transcript, I think it's the middle one. That's going to be your best representation of what will probably be very close to what they're looking at. I say very close is because they actually recalculate all of it based on the grades you enter into their system. Okay, so for example, like they only take, I think it's 8 honors/AP credits. So if you took more than 8 classes, and I think that's even semesters, I have to double check that one. But they limit the number of credits that you can have for AP going forward. So if you took 10 or 12 AP classes, your GPA that's on that transcript may be fairly different than what they actually calculate, because they limit it to make it fair across the board for all students, because not everyone has access to 13 AP classes, for example. Yeah.
Was that unweighted?
Weighted.
Weighted, okay.
Yeah.
So how do they calculate their senior semester, the first one, or do they?
They don't. So it's 10 through 12.
10, 11.
They throw out, 10, oh yeah, sorry, 10, 11. They throw out 9th grade in terms of GPA. They still use 9th grade for eligibility purposes. So if you failed English 9, for example, you are not eligible to apply. But they do not take the GPA from that 9th grade year into account. They only take basically 3 semesters. Is that right? No, 4 semesters. 10th grade and 11th grade semesters, they don't even see your senior year fall semester. Okay, so that's all that they're looking at.
But you do have to enter in what you're...
Yes, so you will be entering in the classes that you're enrolled in. And that's why it's important if you're not totally set on your schedule right now, or maybe you're thinking about like college classes or online classes or whatever it might be, you might not want to start wasting a bunch of time filling in all those classes yet, because things might change. You want to have as close to an accurate year-long schedule when you submit that thing as you can, because any changes that happen throw up big red flags for them. Because basically the next time they're going to see your transcript is at the very end of the year when you graduate. Some schools and programs have started asking for like verification at semester break, but it's not an official thing that we send, like for some of the common app schools, which I'll talk about later. But good question. They do need the SAT reasoning tests and the ACT with writing, so they'll ask you for those, and that's how you'll report those, but you'll also enter them on your application itself. Yeah.
How many tests can you enter? Can you enter like 3 for each or something or more?
I don't know the exact number. I think there's spots for 3 or 4, and I'm not sure if they've added any ability to add additional ones at this point or not. Mm-hmm. I can't recall from last year. That's a good question. I can look it up, though. But yeah, so essentially you do have the opportunity, though, to take additional tests still this year. Okay, so we have the October test. You can still register late for the October SAT. The regular deadline passed on Thursday, I think, last week. But the late deadline's until the 22nd of September, I believe. You also have November and December. Okay, December is kind of that final cutoff date when schools will stop kind of like accepting SAT scores. And how do we do that? Because November 30th is when it's due, right? You basically list anything that you don't have scores back from, you list the date that you're expecting to take the test, and you leave the scores blank. Once you get your test results back, you then update your test scores back to those schools. Okay, and they'll know to look for them. But you do have, if you're not happy with them, or if you haven't taken very many yet, you still have 2 or 3 different opportunities to take the SAT in particular. I don't know the exact dates of the ACT, but you probably have at least 2 time frames left before December 12th. SAT subject tests, or SAT 2s as sometimes they call them, Those are required sometimes for specific majors in a school or specific colleges. Double check on your website. Once you guys have narrowed down exactly what you're going to be looking for at colleges or specific UCs, whether or not you're going to need those SAT2s or not, and which specific subject tests you might need to take. Again, you still have till December to take those SAT subject tests as well, in case you are applying to a major that might need them. Okay, that all should be available either on the admissions site itself, or if you are looking at maybe like nursing or some other programs that are highly competitive or impacted, you might need to also check on the individual kind of like departmental website. Okay. Finally, we talked about the kind of other factors and the personal statement. Personal statements in one slide, I believe, and there's, I'll actually give you the two questions. They have not changed since I've been doing this, and they probably won't change anytime soon. The same questions every year. However, I talked about these different things that colleges set. They actually call it comprehensive review, which means that it's an overall look at a student. I think a couple years ago I put a slide on the screen that had a picture of bark. Okay, and that's all it showed. It was a very close-up picture of a tree, and I asked the parents, please describe this tree. Like, well, you know, it's not an aspen tree. I think it's something, you know, it's got brown bark. But that's all pretty much you could tell. I would call that like the CSU application. That's like, you know, they're like, all they care about is a little bit of an equation and that's it. However, as you get into like the UCs and some of the private schools, they are doing what's called comprehensive review, a holistic look. That kind of, I want to look at the whole tree and see what's going on. Did it get hit by lightning? Is it like dead? All that stuff that's going on with the person. Okay, so they use all these 14 different things. And these are criteria that are not released to anybody. Okay, these are in-house criteria that these individual faculty develop to review student applications. So you can look at all these things, you know, special talents and awards, location even, you know, that does play a factor. They like to admit people local. Schools really like that, and a whole bunch of other things. So personal statements, okay? You're gonna have, for UC application, you're gonna have two questions that you have to answer. You have 1,000 words to do it, and you can split up that 1,000 words however you like. So one question might be standing out more to you or feel like you have a better answer for it, you can write more. However, they do suggest no less than 250 words on either one or the other, okay? I would suggest closer to, you know, trying to keep it kind of even might be a little bit better, unless you're really, really strong on one. The two prompts are this. One is describe the world that you come from, for example, your family, community, your school, and tell us how your world has shaped your dreams and aspirations. Hugely broad, okay? It's almost too hard to answer. It's that broad, okay? So you really have to think and sit down, and I think you guys are even working on English class, right? So that'll give you guys an opportunity to sit and write, but these are not quick write essays. And no essay that you're gonna write is a quick write. You do not, unless you're like 5 minutes from the deadline. But that's why we plan ahead, okay? But this should take you a week or more to sit down, brainstorm, write an outline, get it checked, write it, rewrite it. This stuff can make or break applications if you're neck and neck. I don't think the prompts are, but they're on the website. If you just Google UC prompt, UC personal statement prompts, they're the same every year, so you can get the two offline. For the Common App as well, just before I forget to mention it, the Common App prompts are also online. I believe you pick two of them out of the five that are available to choose from for Common Application. Just so you know, you can Google those as well. Second one is tell us about a personal quality, talent, accomplishment, contribution, or experience that's important to you. What about this quality or accomplishment makes you proud, and how does it relate to the person you are? So again, you want to find something that's you. That's why I suggest the student starting, because you're talking about yourself. They want to hear about you. So spend the time and start writing these things now. Work on it in English, but also work on it at home. It's a great car activity. If you're driving somewhere, pull out a notepad and start writing. Think about activities that you've been involved in. Okay. Try to think of something. It doesn't have to be like, you know, I went and I saved a dog out of a burning building. You know, like life-changing activity. It's great if you have one. That's a great story. But you don't have to like go digging down for this Mother Teresa moment. Okay. You really need to really capitalize on what's most important to you. What do you feel like changed your life? It could be something as small as, you know, something someone said to you one time, and how did that change the course of how you feel about yourself, or how you look at life, and describe it. Okay, it doesn't have to be this big moment. It can be small. Finally, and this is kind of general application question, kind of advice, but you know, specific for the UCs and CSUs too. There's a lot of resources out there for questions. Myself is one of them. People that have done this before is also one of them. However, the UCs and CSUs, believe it or not, they've done a pretty good job at actually trying to answer those questions because they probably get them too, and they know. They get emails from us counselors. People are asking me this like 8 million times. Can you guys fix this? But first of all, read the instructions. You probably are not surprised, actually. How many students come to me and ask me the easiest question? I'm like, it's right there in bold, red, underlined, like on the first page. Did you read the instructions? So make sure that you read the instructions. Sometimes they're not clear, but most of the time they're getting better and better at making it human language and understandable. So please just read through it and then read through it one more time, okay? Because all it takes is misunderstanding or not completing one instruction and your application is not complete. It might ruin your admissions chance, and that's not to make stress on your life, but it's just, you know, please read it. You're not gonna wanna disassemble a bomb without reading the instructions. Same thing with college applications. If you do have questions though, please don't just sit there and pretend like, I don't see that. Ask people. All the applications and all the systems have an FAQ or a help site. Many of them have started creating kind of a live chat help feature even. So if you're stuck on a common application question, check out the chat. You don't have to wait for me tomorrow morning. You can hop online and make a phone call or get online and live chat with someone right then. You can also call the admissions department. If I run into a question that I don't know a specific answer to, maybe I'm not super confident in what I feel like is the answer, I'm going to suggest to you guys, hey, it might be best for you to call and ask that directly to the school. Most of the time, it's not going to be me making the phone call. One, because most importantly, it looks better and it sounds better to have the student actually call the admissions office, because you're taking responsibility. You're not pawning it off on someone else, a parent or a school employee. Okay, I encourage the student to always talk to the school. People are worried about, oh, well, they're taking notes on me. If my parents call, they'll write it down in my file. They're not going to write it down in your file. However, it's just good practice. You're about to be an adult, and on the off chance that one out of a million people, like you're talking to someone that's going to then go back and read your essay or something like that, it's always just best practice to have the student always interact with the college. You could be there like, I'll ask him this. Have them talk. Anytime you guys want, you can always make an appointment with me to sit down and actually review your application before you hit submit. I would suggest it. I catch things all the time. Usually it's little things. Sometimes if you big glaring things like you forgot your name, but it actually happened. Usually things like, your social security has one less digit than you need, or whatever it might be. And again, the applications are getting very good at catching those things automatically, but sometimes they're not that smart. Sometimes you need the human eye to look at it. And then I'll start doing workshops during RTI and stuff like that in the next couple weeks to kind of have like UC application day, CSU application day, Common App application day, community college day, whatever it might be. So look for those events. A few common questions that I get regarding college applications. We do use an exact class ranking system, meaning there can be ties. I think I looked today and I don't think there's many ties, if any. But sometimes you'll have, like, you might see on your transcript, you'll see class rank, and it'll say, you know, you'll compare what you get. Well, I'm one, okay, I'm two, I'm five. My GPA is like right below yours. Well, who's two, who's three, four, who's three and four? And there's not actually three and four, there's three twos. Okay, so there's ties, and so it can be a little confusing if you're comparing. Most of the time, you're probably not gonna really get that in depth, but just so you know, because sometimes the applications will ask that. And we use your weighted A through G course GPA from grades 10 and 11. For CSU and UC applications. For all other applications, it's usually what they ask us to do, or I typically use their total academic weighted GPA. Academic throws out PE and pathways and stuff like that. Okay. Any questions about UCs at all, or any other questions so far? Kind of see where we're at. Okay. CSUs, this is going to be much faster than UCs because it's probably the easiest application you'll ever do, even for like your driver's license, that kind of thing. It's literally you're going to fill out your name, contact information, you'll have your transcript, you'll fill in your classes, you'll select the schools that you want to apply to, pay your money, and hit submit. One of the easiest applications you'll have to do. they are available, not, or I'm sorry, they are not available right now. So the CSU application is done through CSU Mentor, and that actually become available October 1st. Once that October 1st date hits, you can submit at any time between October 1st and November 30th. So that's important because you might want to like stagger your applications. You might want to work on Common App early or late, depending on when your application deadlines are. Maybe start the CSUs in October, work on getting those things submitted in October, work on your UC applications to get submitted in November, and it kind of helps stagger out your workload. And probably someone in here is thinking, does it actually help to submit early? No. So unless you're applying early decision, and we'll talk about these different application types, for like specifically the CSUs and UCs, they literally throw you into this big pile of applications and then spit them out to readers at 12:01 a.m. December 1st. So there's no benefit of getting it in October 1st versus November 30th. The only warning I will give you is November 30th, their computers do crash. So do not wait. And there are no excuses. They will not. You will not be able to call up and say, I really want to go UC Berkeley. I waited and your computers crashed. I couldn't even submit it. They'll say, why didn't you submit it earlier? And there's no excuses. Literally, they will not. They won't laugh in your face, but they will make no exceptions, unless you were like deathly ill and have some like catastrophic life-changing excuse. They're not very sympathetic. You have
also for East Coast colleges, remember the time.
Yeah, time differences as well.
Issue.
And some other schools, even on the West Coast, have servers that are on the East Coast that are set to a different time. Most of the time by now, I think most of the big ones have caught that, but there might be one or two. I always suggest do not push the deadline. Just turn it in, you know, set your own deadline a day early. That's the easiest.
There isn't any advantage to when you're also looking at financial aid packages or what those colleges have to offer to apply.
I'll talk about financial aid a little bit later.
Okay.
But financial aid and applications are two completely separate things.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I will talk about getting that in and some things that go along with that. Yeah.
And so on this Cal State one, no recommendation and
nope.
No personal statement.
Nope. So easiest thing. No letters of recommendation, no personal statements. You don't even have to write other than your class, you know, your information in the system. You do need to submit tests, yes, and I think that's on the next slide. You have one application for all 23 campuses. Again, you're going to tick off which schools you want to actually apply to. You just pay the fee per campus that you're going to go apply to. Again, do not apply to 23 campus. It's very expensive. But, you know, a couple is probably a pretty safe bet. CSUs are a very popular set of schools here. The last thing I'll mention about CSUs for this slide is that many campuses are becoming impacted, if not severely impacted already. And what impaction means is they are actually trying to decrease their enrollment because they are so full they can't fit kids in dorms, classrooms, they don't have enough professors or enough money to actually hire and build new buildings to be able to hold all these kids. This is kind of the result of people getting, you know, kind of going back to school, working back on their degrees, that kind of thing, because a lot of people are coming in. The affordability and access of college for students has grown greater, so more and more people, and this is one of the most accessible types of school, I would say probably in the nation, because it's one of the larger state university systems, but definitely in California. So again, yeah, no essay, personal statement, no letters of recommendation. Eligibility is, again, based on those A through G grades and those classes you complete. You must complete those A through G requirements. And literally, you get narrowed down to an equation. So this is the bad guy that kind of, like, trumps all my, oh, you're not just your GPA and grades. For CSUs, you're pretty much your GPA and your grades and your test scores. Okay, so the good news and bad news is most of the time, as long as you're applying broadly in the CSUs, you'll get into CSU. As long as you meet that A through G requirement most of the time, you start getting into a little trouble when you start getting below a 3.0. Then you have to validate scores with test scores. It gets more complicated. But most people with 3.0, you will get into AACSU most likely. It may not be Cal Poly. It may not be Long Beach or San Diego State. Okay, that's why you want to have some choice. But you can get in, and most people will. But basically, there's an equation. It's GPA times 800 plus, you know, your SAT score without writing, and that's your eligibility index. Most school minimums, and I'm going to a conference on this next week or the week after, where I'll get updated numbers, but For last year, and it's probably fairly similar, minimum that they're going to be looking for is 2,900. And that's fairly generous, just so you know. So you don't have to do the math. It's fairly generous. It's like, you don't have to blow the SATs out of the water. Your GPA doesn't have to be 4.5. You know, that's pretty good. If you're a non-resident, you live in Nevada or something like that, it's going to be a much higher number. Most people probably live in California. Any question about that slide at all? Yeah.
I have one question about the SAT. So if they're going to take the SAT in October, should they wait for those test results before they apply to the Cal State system?
Probably. I don't know if they'll get them in time. They can. You can wait and see how long it takes them to get back. Many times when they're kind of processing all these reports and these score reports and stuff like that, they get kind of bogged down with a lot of their processes and stuff. You can try, but it's kind of up to you. There's not really a suggestion I have either way. If you want to wait, you can wait. It just means you submit your application before November 30th. If they don't come in, just make sure you submit it and leave it blank, and then you just send in your test scores once you get them.
Oh, so you can just do that?
Yeah, you don't need to, once, if you leave it blank, you don't need to go back and update your application. You just send your test scores with the new test, the test that you're waiting on in, and they add it to your account. Somehow, magically. Just to give you an idea, just like it with UCs, I didn't break down all 23 campuses, but most competitive schools, they're sitting at a 31% entrance admissions rate. Cal Poly, Long Beach, San Diego State, those are going to be your hardest schools to get into. Again, they're denying 2 out of 3 students. So don't always, just have that in mind. Don't let it discourage you, but have it in mind. You're not the only one if you get denied. Least competitive schools in the kind of system are Sonoma State, Humboldt State, Stanislaus, Chico, San Bernardino. Those are great schools. I know a lot of people, all of our teachers graduated from Chico. I have not been to Chico, so I cannot brag from personal experience, but I hear great things about Chico. Awesome things. Same thing about Sacramento State. These are all schools that are very accessible and fairly safe. Okay, so you might want to think about it. Do some research in some of these schools. And see if you'd be a good fit there. It might not be a good fit for everybody, but it might be a good school just to, if you're applying, it might cost you 55 extra bucks and you submit your application, you got maybe another admit, and you have more choice. Choice is not a bad thing. It gets hard later, but to start off, it's a good thing. SAT scores, ACT scores, you send them to one place, not the school. You might want to write this code down. This is something you might want to write down. You send it to the CSU mentor score reporting place. I don't know what they call it on the thing. Institution, maybe. But the code that you're going to need to send the SAT scores to is 3594. You send one SAT report to that code, that location, when you're ordering your reports, and it'll be accessible to all 23. Okay, so you don't have to order 10 different scores if you're doing that. ACT is a different process. I don't think they are. You'll have to look that up. We mainly do the SATs, so it should be a fairly similar process. They might have, I just don't have the code available. Yes?
For CSU, if you're well above the index for eligibility, do you need to send both sets of scores, or you just always send both sets of scores?
I suggest let them make the decision, not you. Let them figure out which one they want to use and which one they value more. Instead of just trying to figure that out, maybe they like the other one better. That's just my advice.
And then for, if your child's taking the SATs, 3 different times or whatever, then you just pick one date that you did the best, or how do you do that?
All the test reports come with all the scores on them.
Okay. So when we send it in, they're going to show he tested this date and got these scores, that date, got those scores.
Not CSUs.
No. Some out of state.
Private schools will super score them, which helps and hurts. So super score, if you're not familiar with what super scoring is, you have... CSUs, UCs, what they do is they look at a test score and they'll say, okay, we're going to take the highest single sitting. So your October test date, if that's your highest, that's the one we're going to use. Mm-hmm. Super scoring is what a lot of private schools typically will use, or outside the state sometimes will use, and it's actually not that popular. There's not a ton of schools that do it, but just so you guys know what it is. They'll actually look at individual sections of the test, doesn't matter if it's the same date, and they'll add up your highest section. And why I said it can help but hurt, it can help because it could possibly give you a better score, but it can also give someone else a much better score than even you. Okay, you might have had a better single sitting, you might have rocked one date, but they were like, I'm going to test only for the math, I'm gonna test only for the English, and I'm gonna test only for the writing, and they might rock your, you know, rock your world on the super score. Okay, so it can definitely hurt you if that's the case. That's probably far not gonna happen, but it can. Just so you guys know. And again, do not try to remember your classes. Always use your transcript. Do not fabricate anything on your applications. You want to use as close. You want to use exactly what they're going to get on their transcripts. Okay. So don't try to guess. Don't try to fill in grades. Oh, I think I got a B minus. You need to like have that stuff in front of you when you're filling it out. And I'm happy to print out transcripts if you need them. You can also access them through Aries at home. The ones we print out are typically a little bit easier to read sometimes, but you can easily access them at home. Do you have a question? No? And always use your exact version of your name. Don't use any nicknames, as it's on your birth certificate, social security number card, whatever it might be, official documentation, passport, that's the name you should use. Private colleges, so we covered UCs, CSUs, private colleges. And this is going to go quick because they're very broad. Okay, there's so many different private colleges out there. It's hard to get really specific because, you know, there's thousands of them. But kind of overall idea about private colleges is the deadlines vary widely. All right, from October 15th, I think, is typically kind of one of the earliest dates, usually, to all the way in the spring, March, May even sometimes. And they have a wide variety of different types of applications. And I'll go in depth about the application types because there's some very important, like, legal and financial information that you need to know about different application types in just a second with a comparison chart. For most private colleges, they're going to have two ways of applying usually. They're going to have their own application, or they're going to be on the common application. The common application is an application that you do a general overall application, and then you have specific subsets for individual colleges that are a part of this common application. And there are 603 colleges that are in this kind of group that use this application. So it's very popular. More than likely, you're going to use probably that at least once when you're applying. Most many students will. Okay, so when you're looking at the common application, and I have a slide about that as well, just with some specific points about it. But most private colleges are going to look for, this is where your letters of recommendation are going to become very important. And private colleges are anything from Stanford to Sierra Nevada College in Incline. Sierra Nevada College is a private college. Okay, so these, they vary widely in terms of what people think you know, private colleges are. And some are very selective, and some are not so selective. Okay, so there's a broad range. However, they do need typically letters of recommendation, and most of the time it's two from a teacher. They can specify you can use one as a coach, but one, at least one, will you typically need to come from a teacher or school staff, and typically one needs to come from me. And I think, I don't know if I told you guys this morning or not, but I think there's a question, well, what if I want someone else to write me a letter? You know, what if, what if you're a new student to the school and I don't really know you that well? Or you think Miss Mitchell might be able to write you a better letter than I could. That's totally fine. Okay, the only stipulation that I have is I need you to ask me who, and I need to know kind of who this person is. You know, I want to know kind of what their qualifications are. They should be a school official of some sort, slash I would consider like a college counselor that you're working with outside of the school in submission in place of mine. My other stipulation is I have to be able to read it. I'm not going to submit anything that I feel like is fabricated, is paid for, because basically it's my letter that we're substituting. Okay, so those are my two stipulations. So if you have those things, I'm happy to do that. But I'm happy also to write letters for any student that I'm able to. There's a secondary school report that has information about GPA, a whole bunch of stuff that I fill out that you guys don't really have to worry about. A mid-year report is fairly common for private schools. Okay, a mid-year report is something different than the CSUs and UCs do, is I send in this pretty much all the stuff, minus the letters of recommendation, again, with an updated transcript and any changes in their schedule. The reason they do this is because they want to see how you actually did that first semester before they make a decision about you. That's the main difference in terms of, like, application timelines from the CSUs and UCs and these private schools. They're typically going to tell you a little bit later because they want to see this. Let me see if I have it up there. No. So regarding letters of recommendation, a couple things. Yeah.
Before we go into that, what's secondary school report?
That's something that I fill out.
Okay.
So it's a part of the application that we send,
okay.
But it's things like, oh, your class rank, the classes you're taking that I write in, your GPA, any recommendations that I send in, that kind of thing.
Okay.
So that's what that is. It's,
okay.
But I put it up there so you know that that's going along with your application. That's a part of it.
So a teacher recommendation and you?
Typically,
qualified.
Yeah. Each
okay.
school on the Common App in particular is going to have their own requirements. They'll tell you pretty specifically.
Okay.
And for the Common App, you do have to tie it to Naviance. I went over some of it with the students this morning. But if they get lost or forget, I can go over that with them again.
And it could yep. be a teacher that's no longer here?
It can. It might be kind of challenging. Yeah, if that's the case, you might need to like ask me for some like specific help about how to get that going and that kind of thing, because there's a lot of different steps and process in place to make that happen. So letters of recommendation, as we're talking about it, just so you guys know as parents, kind of what our expectation is here. Our teachers are typically very happy and eager to write letters of recommendation for your kids. As in myself, Ms. Mitchell, Ms. Padilla, Blanca, I'm sure would be willing to write letters. Anybody here is very happy to. However, we're not required to. Okay. So nothing in our job description, nothing in the law, nothing in anything tells us you have to write a letter for anybody that asks you or demands you to write a letter. Okay. I don't say that to be mean, but I say it because if I can't write you a good letter, I'm not going to write you a letter. Because a poorly written, you know, yeah, they took good classes, they seem nice, actually does worse for students than actually not writing a letter at all. So if I can't write you one that I feel I can put like my full confidence behind, that I think this is gonna, you know, really help you out, I'll probably talk to you and say, you know, no, you know, you got caught smoking pot like 10 times, like I don't feel like I can write you a great letter. Or I don't know you well enough, I don't know enough about you really to write you a great letter. Is there anybody else that you feel like you can substitute in my place that you feel like knows you better to write you a letter of recommendation? So that's probably one of the two options that you'll hear from me. Hopefully not the pot one, but the substitution is typically what I'll suggest if I can't write you a good one. Teachers as well can say no, but and they might suggest either talk to another teacher. I didn't have you very much. We weren't very interactive in class. I can't really speak about your academic ability other than your grades. Or they might just be inundated with requests. There are a few popular teachers at school that you probably can think of who they are. If you know that you want a letter from them, you might want to jump on it pretty quickly, because they get busy, and they occasionally will say, no, I can't write anymore right now. You know, if you can wait 3 or 4 weeks, I might be able to write you one, but right now I'm busy with, you know, I have 20 other letters I got to write. And it takes us about 1.5 to 2 hours to write a decent letter and get everything sent and kind of completed and on letterhead and all that stuff. So it takes a good amount of time, and we want to make sure we put the right amount of effort in, because it really does make a big difference for student applications. We do require at least 2 weeks notice. I can't guarantee that I'll get anything writ if you tell me, or writ, I work at a school, written under that 2 week window, okay, just because of other appointments I got going on. I got a bunch of other stuff happening at school, and some of it's not expected. So 2 weeks is kind of like that kind grace period, and same thing for teachers. But please do follow up if you ask us, you know, 3 weeks and hey, I have a deadline of November 30th for this thing and it's August 15th. Don't just like assume that we're going to take care of it and not forget. As students, do check in and make sure, hey, you know, after 2 weeks, remember I asked you to do this. I just want to check in and see how that's going and if you need anything else from me to help you write it. That's all you gotta do, and then say, hey, I just remind you that it's due on 30th, you know, we have a couple more weeks to get it in, just want to see where you're at. Because people forget, people get buried in things, and we don't want to forget your letters. The last thing about letters recommendation is, I won't even start writing it until I see a senior profile. Senior profiles are available in the front office. It's basically a 3-page form that has information, kind of like a broken down resume, okay? A lot of students, I think some of them got it in Pathways and some of the other classes before, but there's always copies available in the little roundabout paper thing in the office. So I would encourage you guys to get started on that, because I've asked teachers to do the same thing. So if you guys want an example of what it looks like to ask for a letter of recommendation, you walk into a classroom very nicely, preferably not when they're in the middle of teaching, and say, hey, Miss J, how's it going? Good. Hey, so I was hoping that you'd be willing to write me a letter of recommendation. So I'm applying to this college, and this college, and I think that you'd be able to speak well about my abilities as a student. Does that sound okay with you? You say, yeah, I'd be very happy to write you a letter. Okay, great. Here, you know, I wanted to give you my senior profile, and I actually even printed out a list of my deadlines for you that I stapled to my senior profile and all the colleges I'm applying to, just to help you remind you. You know, just to help remind you. Great. Okay, so is it okay if I follow up with you in about 2 weeks? See how it's going. Yeah, sure. Cool. Have a good day. That's it. Okay? And then you just got to follow up on your side. Okay, so it's very simple, but you do have to ask and be very polite about it. All right. We promise we're moving along. We're not too far from the end. But this is a fairly important slide, so I want to make sure that we spend some time talking about it. Because this, if any part of the application process has legal and financial ramifications in the negative side of things, it's this slide. And in particular, when you're talking about private and common application schools. This does not really apply necessarily so much to the CSUs and UCs, because they typically they have a priority application deadline, and it doesn't really mean much. And not every school is going to even have that. But basically, we have two sides of this form, of this slide. The right side, if you can't read it, says restrictive application plans, because you can apply different ways. Many private schools will have what's called early decision. That's the big one. That's the big red flag that I want you guys to have in your mind. Because early decision, or sometimes called ED, if you're seeing that on an application, apply early decision or ED, what that is that student is saying, this is my first choice school. If I get admitted here and everywhere else, I'm going to go through and cancel all my applications and definitely enroll in your school. And the big reason why that's important is because, one, you'll apply early. You can only pick one early decision school. You cannot apply early decision any other places. The other reason is it's binding. I mean, you're going to sign a big legal contract that says, by applying early decision, I am now agreeing that if you admit me, I will now enroll in the fall no matter what. Okay. That also means that they can come after you legally for tuition if you do not. Okay. So if you don't end up going there, I don't know about you, but I do not want to pay two tuition bills. And they have in the past. It takes very extenuating circumstances to get out of that early decision contract. So double check. This is for the student that I know exactly what I want to do. And really what this does is these people that, these college admissions officers, they're not even called that anymore. They're called enrollment managers now. It's a business. Whether they're for-profit or not-for-profit, they're in the business of getting students in their doors and paying tuition and paying fees and using their services. And what this does is it gets them a for-sure butt in the seat and a for-sure check in the mail every semester, because they know, hey, because like you saw with Berkeley, they had 79,000 people apply. They admitted 13,000. Not all 13 of those 1,000 people actually showed up and enrolled. So they need to meet a certain number of people, or else they can't build their building, they can't build their, you know, their stadium, whatever it might be. And so this is an easy way to say, I know that I have 500 more students guaranteed in the fall. It does help your chances. Okay, it's going to depend on how much by what campus you're looking at, from a lot to just fairly slightly. But it will give you a leg up, mainly for that reason of, You're showing guaranteed interest. You're showing this is my number one spot. If I don't get in anywhere else, you're my favorite. And that helps. It's not a guarantee that you're going to get in, but that is a very important binding contract. So make sure that you know that. Read through all of the information. It's not like iTunes where you can skip through, you know, the 5 pages of information. You need to read that one, because that will be big if you screw that up. Restrictive early action is a non-binding contract, meaning they will not come after you legally. However, very similar to the early decision, you can only apply to one REA, or restrictive early action school. And that's also limiting. So if you apply to early decision, you can't apply to an REA school. You can choose one or the other. Okay, so those are the restrictive plans. Similar kind of idea in terms of the help in the application and support, but it's a little less like impacting on your application. They're going to look a little bit less favorably on that than an early decision, but it's still very helpful if this is your top choice. On the left-hand side, we have non-restrictive application plans. Regular decision is your standard application. You apply, You submit your stuff, you hear back early spring usually, and you're good to go. You're kind of with everybody else. No negatives or positives on either side. Rolling admissions, so Montana State, Reno, UNR, they're on what's called rolling admissions. And what that is, it's kind of nice sometimes, is they're typically kind of the less selective. Less selective is not equal to poor education, by the way. Less selective just means that there's not as many students wanting to get in. But they're less selective in that what they do is you apply, they'll have a window of time, say August through April. And you apply, and they'll process your application within 2 to 3 weeks usually. And you'll have an admissions decision pretty quickly. So what's nice about that is you can have 10 applications, you have one rolling admissions, you could have already have an admit in your hand, you know, 3 or 4 weeks later, before you even have submitted your other applications. So it kind of makes you, it gives you a little bit of confidence boots, gives you a little bit of safety net if one of those schools is a rolling admissions school. And then early action, that's one that you'll typically see as well. That just kind of says, hey, I kind of like your school, you're above the rest of them. There's no limit on the number of schools you can apply early action, but typically they will have an earlier deadline. And both the early decision, REA, and early action are going to have typically an earlier admissions notification day as well. So you're kind of signing up to hear back earlier whether you got in or not. But it's just important to know all those different terms, EA, ED, REA, regular decision, rolling admissions. Any questions about that? Because that is a big deal. Yeah?
If you go like early decision or restrictive early action, and they put you, will they wait list you on those?
Depends on the campus. Okay. Some campuses I've heard of, so typically what will happen is in many schools, not all schools, and they all can make up their own decision how they want to do this, but in many cases what's going to happen is if you apply early decision and you don't get in many most schools, when you start looking at like Stanford, Harvard, that kind of thing, it's usually a one-shot stop.
Right.
But when you look at the majority of these schools that have early decision, you'll apply early decision. If you don't get in, they'll push you to the regular decision
okay.
with everybody else. If you don't get into regular decision, they might wait list you after that.
Okay.
So it's not all schools, but I would say that's the vast majority do that. Any other questions about this at all?
So with the CSU, is that...
They're regular decision. On this here, they're regular decision.
This is right.
You might see something about priority deadline or something like that. It really does not mean a whole lot.
Okay.
So,
University of Oregon has early action.
Uh-huh.
They didn't say restrictive early action.
Right. So there's early action. It's non-binding. It's basically you're essentially kind of showing a little bit of proactivity and saying you're really
okay.
popular in my book,
okay.
and also signing up to both apply early and typically and hear back earlier.
But it will say restrictive.
Yeah,
if it is restricted.
They will use those exact terms
okay.
if they have those different plans.
Okay.
And you might be able to choose from all those different plans, depending on the school. They usually won't have ED, REA, EA, they won't have all of them. They usually have one or two.
Okay.
But that's it. Any other questions about this slide? I'm going to kind of keep going and hopefully finish fairly quickly. We kind of talked about that. So Naviance, we worked with students a little bit today. I apologize, students. I know it was very boring. It's kind of dry logistical stuff, so it's not the most exciting workshop today. However, that Naviance account will be fairly important to your senior this year. I need all applications to be added to this account. That includes two-year college applications and even trade schools. So all students in here that I see have accounts. There's only two or three seniors that are new to our school this year that don't. But I showed you guys also kind of how to request transcripts. You can request transcripts to Naviance. All of your common application correspondence needs to go through here. You can continue researching schools. There's some great research tools. So make sure that you're on here. Most of the time, seniors, it's probably going to be a weekly, semi-weekly like visit. You need to be on here pretty frequently. I also use this to communicate with you guys pretty often. Usually it just lets me spit out emails to all you guys. So be sure you're checking your emails. And that reminds me, it's very important for all of you guys to check emails. Because many times parent emails are included in certain things, and you guys might get updates of, hey, we didn't get your FAFSA report in, or something like that. But you want to make sure that you're checking it. Don't get buried in 10,000 emails, because you might miss a very important one. Yeah?
When you email us, do you usually send it to our school email? Or
I send it to whatever email you're connected to Naviance about or with. So, but if I email you like from my Gmail account, I typically will use the school email just because your name's in there and I feel like that's a more professional thing to do. Yeah, make sure you're checking your emails. Also voicemails. Make sure you have a voicemail set up and check them. Schools will call, schools will email. They're usually emailing nowadays, but they do call. And you know, if they're missing application pieces, if you're coming up on a deadline, they don't have things, you know, and they really want you. If you're like UC Berkeley, they're not going to call you.
Yeah.
You're on your own. But you know, there are certain places. You know, if you're an athletics recruitment person, whatever it might be, that might be super important to you. So just make sure you're keeping communication. Skip that. I covered that with students. Community college. I want to make sure I cover some of this. So there are 112 community colleges in the state of California. The most popular ones that people are going to be going to from here typically are going to be in the Sacramento area, Sierra College in Truckee and in Rockland, and then also TMCC or Career College Northern Nevada is also another popular one that are kind of in our regional area. South Lake Tahoe also has a community college, and so those are all kind of within driving distance and reasonably close. But it's fairly easy to become a community college student. Some of you guys have already taken dual enrollment courses with community colleges. However, all you need to do to become a full-time community college student is, one, graduate high school. Typically, they have waivers, but you usually need to be 18 years of age, which most high school seniors are. There are placement tests, so you do not need SATs, you do not need ACTs to become a community college student. And this is great for people seeking out certifications, as well as seeking out transfers. So sometimes people don't think about transfer options. Transferring is a great way to go. It's not for everybody, but sometimes, like I said earlier, it can be cheaper. However, there's a couple things that you got to keep in mind. You'll hear stats spit out about, only 17 people that start as a transfer actually transfer in 2 years. I would say that stat's a little bit false, but it is fairly low. And not because they can't. In most cases, it's mostly because they don't have a plan. They've said, oh, I want to work 40 hours a week and go to school. And so students, if you're becoming a transfer path, you're going to be a transfer student to go get your four-year degree after 2 years at community college, or if you want to work on an AA degree, just have a plan. Know what you want to be. Are you going to be a full-time student? Are you able to be a full-time student? Or are you going to be working half-time? And then don't expect to get out in 2 years. If you're going to work half-time and take half a load of credits, it's going to take you 4 years to complete 2 years of work. Most community colleges have pretty close agreements with UCs and CSUs. So say, for example, you're a student that maybe you didn't work so hard in 9th and 10th grade, but then you figured out, hey, I do want to go to college. I'd like to get my bachelor's degree in biology. What can I do? Because I'm not really eligible to apply right off the bat to a CSU, perhaps. You can apply as a transfer student, and they actually have what's called an associate's degree for transfer, as well as typically agreements with all the UCs, but very closely with the ones around that specific community college, that if you complete their kind of set standards, you're essentially guaranteed a transfer spot to a certain level. And that's nice because they don't actually look at high school grades. They don't look at SAT scores. So if you screwed up in ninth grade, you got a couple of Fs, D, a couple of Cs here and there, you know, you can still go to college, you can still get a degree. It just might not start at Sacramento State, it might start at Sacramento City College. And some people are like, well, that's less of a degree. When you graduate from Sacramento State, it doesn't say Sacramento State, but I started at Sacramento City College. It says Sacramento State. It doesn't have anything to do with where you started that process and that kind of path. Okay, so it's very important to think about that. The biggest thing that's going to get you through in 2 years or through your degree process at any level, but especially at the community college level, is to have a plan. There are people that work at colleges in a very similar role to myself, called academic advisors, that you guys need and you students need to meet with, I would say, almost every semester. Okay, they're the people that are going to help you plan out the course sets that you're going to take. They're the people that are going to tell you, hey, you got to take this test to get into this next, you know, this next class or this next kind of graduate program, whatever it might be. You need to sit down, and they will actually map out what you're going to need to do over the next 4 years and help you get through that process. I know, thinking back to my college experience, I wish I would have seen my academic advisor more often. So I highly encourage you to do that. Most of the time they're pretty nice people, and sometimes they can even help you, like, get classes that you're, you know, waitlisted on or something like that, because they have the powers. So they can help you guys in certain circumstances. If you have that relationship, if you just stroll in, hey, I need off this waitlist and I don't know who you are, they're not going to be very helpful. But if you're talking to them on a regular basis, you build that relationship, they're going to probably bend over backwards to make sure that they can help you. So that's that plan that you guys need to have. No admissions to community college is all enrollment, so you're not going to get denied as long as you have those kind of check marks. But always check for transfer agreements and that pathway to that transfer if that's your goal, or that associate's degree or certificate, whatever you might want to end up with. Enrollment dates for community college are much later. Okay, so usually starting early spring will be when enrollment starts for fall. So you'll need to actually pay attention to different websites, because they're not a specific start and end date like some of the CSUs and UCs. There is financial aid for community college. Okay, and that's where we're kind of going right now, is into that quick financial aid talk. Most of my financial aid stuff is going to have to wait a little bit later, till November, December timeframe, when we get a little bit closer to the January 1st filing date for FAFSA. Just because I only have 10 minutes left. But basically, guys, FAFSA, DREAM Act, is for people that do not have Social Security numbers. You still qualify for California financial aid, which can make school much more affordable and accessible. But the FAFSA is what most people are going to fill out. And the free application for federal student aid, the keyword there is free. You should never pay for anything having to do with the FAFSA. You might need someone to do your taxes for you, but for filing the FAFSA, you should not have to pay anybody to actually submit the form. It's usually pretty straightforward. You might want someone to give you financial advice based on what you're at financially, and possible ways that you can use a 529 or whatever it is. And that's not me, guys. I'm not a financial planner. I can help you guys file the FAFSA. I can decipher some of the things. But if you guys have, you know, four houses and a business and all that stuff, find a financial advisor. I can give you some advice on some people that I know people have worked with in the past. But that it typically pays off. You might spend $1,000, $2,000, but usually it also lowers your EFC, or expected family contribution, by that or more. For college purposes. So that would be something to look into. You guys, these are all questions that, if you guys are stuck, not sure what to do yet, or you haven't figured out your classes, again, this PowerPoint's in that resource folder. So I highly encourage you to read this, but if you get stuck, go back and look at these questions. Just some thought thinking questions about what you're thinking about for colleges next year or the year after, and so on and so forth. So wrapping it up, what to do before you decide, because we go through this entire application process that's exhausting and time-consuming and stressful, and then you finally get back all your results, and hopefully you get several admits to kind of choose from, but then what do you have to do? Okay, believe it or not, that's probably actually the most stressful part, is that end decision point, because, you know, I said with students, I don't know which one to choose. How do you choose between two awesome schools that I want to? I think this one's got a great, you know, ski team. This one's got a great engineering program. I don't know which one's more important to me. So it can get fairly complicated. The other thing you have to think about too, and this is something as parents that I encourage you guys to think about now, and talk about as a family, and maybe even look at your finances and see what you can actually afford for these colleges you're applying to. I don't want you to apply to 10 schools that are way outside your financial ability to pay. Because you're gonna get admitted, and then you gotta figure out how to pay for it. So having a conversation with your family or your spouse, and you're also your student, so they know. You should tell them, okay, this is how much mom and dad, or mom, dad and dad, or mom and mom can, you know, essentially pitch in to help you. Above this amount per year, if you're gonna want to go to this school, you're gonna have to take out loans to get there. Okay. And this is our advice on, you know, what maybe a reasonable amount of loans that we think that you might be able to take out and still graduate and be able to pay those off. And yes or no, we're going to be able to take out Parent Plus loans to help you. Okay, I'll go over the specifics about all the different types of loans at that other financial aid piece, because they can get fairly like nitty gritty on each different type. But one great way to actually look and see if it's an affordable college is to get online. And most colleges on their website will have what's called a net cost calculator, or total cost of attendance calculator. and it's going to ask you for some basic tax information, family size, that kind of thing, and it's going to spit out kind of what their estimate of how much they think you might need to pay per year. And that's an important note, because some people look at that and say, oh, you know, that's, I can do that for a year, but it's really 4 years or five, depending on which school you go to. FAFSA will start January 1st, and to answer the question, I think, about filling out the FAFSA early, there is a slight benefit, and it's slight, and typically you'll see it more so at private schools, schools with big endowments and a lot of money to give away from their own institutional aid. You're not gonna, it's not going to matter so much at public, like state institutions, but they do have pots of money, and they call them a lot of different things that they actually can give away, and they do that sometimes in first come, first serve fashion. So for that purpose it is, I do suggest trying to get in as soon as possible, and the way that you do that is you actually use an estimated tax information. So you're going to fill it out on January 1st, you can get all the way through, complete it all, and put in estimated taxes. I usually suggest look at what you did this year, look at last year, if it's pretty close, use last year's tax information. You just need to go back and update it after you filed your taxes. Okay, but that gets you in a waiting list. That puts your name in a line, and it doesn't matter how often you go back and update it, that first submission, once you get that submission and confirmation, that's kind of your spot. Okay, so that's why submitting early with an estimation or an estimate is always encouraged, because you can have that possible access to additional pools of money that could become available to you depending on your situation. Let's see. I think that will be almost it. Let me see how many more is after this. So basically deciding, guys, if you guys are looking at, get to that point where you've done all the applications, you got your results. Once you actually have to sit down and decide, I always like to create a spreadsheet or some sort of, you know, one page for each college, and you write down, okay, the name of the college, you're going to write down, I was admitted to this program. Write all the information you can, pros and cons about each school. Write how much total cost is going to be, how much out-of-pocket cost it's going to cost you, what their 4 or 6 year graduation rates are, because believe it or not, that makes a huge difference. If your student can graduate even in 4 years versus five, that's another $25,000 to $30,000 in tuition that you're not losing out on. Plus, it's a year of $30,000 to $60,000 of income that student probably can make. So it's a big $100,000 difference in probably like total amount of money spent slash earned that a four-year graduation, you know, can change to 5 years. So when you look at 4 years, that might even make a difference between your first and second choice school. If you can get out of here in 4 years, you know, or they have a four-year guaranteed graduation program that they can say, you are gonna get out of here in 4 years no matter what. Someone said the other day that UCLA made them actually sign a form saying you will graduate, because we don't have any space for you in 4 years. You're not gonna dilly-dally and waste time. But that's something to think about. That's a lot of money. $100,000 is a bunch of money. Compare all those events, kind of data points, and then it really becomes doing your best homework to make a gut decision, listening to your student, listening to your gut, and finally you just have to make a decision. Decision day is May 1st. Almost all colleges will need a decision and a deposit by May 1st to hold your spot in that admissions line. So if you get to that May 1st kind of time frame, and you know, AP tests are about to happen, all that other stuff, it gets busy again, graduation, remember, you need to still, you know, have money in the bank to pay a deposit. You need to, deposits range from anywhere from $250 to, you know, $1,000 or more. They usually will tell you. But be ready to make that decision. Think about it, but don't overthink. Don't ruin the last part of your high school career by stressing out so much about the decision you're about to make that probably either one's going to be a great decision no matter where you end up. But if you kind of sit there for 3 weeks and stress about, I don't know which one to do, you know, it kind of ruins this last little bit of high school that you have left. Okay, so think about it, but don't overthink it. And then you just have to make a decision and make a deposit. You can always talk to people. I'll skip some of this stuff. The only thing I'll add is, so there's more things at the end that you guys can download. The one thing I'll add about deciding, and this shows that you're a professional student, and colleges really appreciate it, is that if you are admitted to 3 or 4 schools and you place a deposit on one, always call the schools that you're not going to be going to and rescind your, say, no, thank you for the admissions, but I've accepted somewhere else. This is a couple of things. One, it does show that you're responsible, that you're professional, and the schools really appreciate it. But two, it really helps those students out on wait lists. If you're on a wait list, trust me, it's stressful. You're sitting there waiting and waiting and waiting to see if you actually get in or not. And some people do, some people don't. But when people don't actually call up and cancel their applications, they cannot open spots in the wait list because they don't know if you're actually going to show up or not. So it really helps those people. And please, please, please do not put two or three deposits down. It might make some sense, we'll save two or three spots and we'll be out $500, something like that, but we can have choices later. Colleges do not like it, and sometimes they talk and they might cancel all of your applications. So just do, you know, you want to be above board on all of this process from financial aid to applications, and just do things by the book, and you guys are going to have a great application season. You know, I think everyone here has great opportunities to be successful. I'm very optimistic about our class that's going through this year. We've got a very bright set of kids that are going to be going places, so I'm very excited to see what happens. But basically, kids, you guys, it's in your hands now. We're here to help. That's kind of where we're at. So you guys are driving. I hope you guys drive well. Don't drive too fast and don't drive too slow, but go straight. Any questions before we are done? And again, if you guys have any other questions that you think about when you go home, hop online, shoot me an email, set up an appointment, come in and we'll sit down and talk. One thing, parents, that while I think about it, I am going to be meeting with all seniors and starting probably in the next week or two. I'm sitting down and I'll probably go through alphabetically just because it's easiest for me to keep track. If you want to meet sooner than that, you can set up an appointment with me. But I'll sit down for probably 30, 40, 45 minutes with each senior and talk about everything that's going on this year and make sure we have everything updated, we're all on the same page. If you would like to come to that meeting, I definitely invite you. I probably won't, I'm not going to, if I'm calling students out, I'm not going to like wait for parents to show up, that kind of thing. But if you want to come to a meeting, just set up an appointment with me and say senior meeting, and we can sit down and talk together with a parent there as well. Or if you want to let them be the adults and do that and then come ask everything that we talked about, that's fine too. But yeah, just let go, let them be their senior self. Just don't be senioritis, that's the bad thing. Any questions? Ooh, I don't know how I can do like 8 of these in 2 weeks.
How many colleges, percentage-wise, maybe make you declare a major? Is it high now?
It's increasing. I would say it's still not on the mini side. The CSUs and UCs, not tons. There are undeclared options in many of them. But we're seeing more and more, mainly because there's more and more enrollment, and they're going to, they need to know how many students are going into what program and how many seats they have in programs so that they just know what their enrollments are going to be.
Does that set you, though, or can you?
Depends on the school. Cal Poly, it's going to be extreme. For example, that's the one I know. They're going to make you declare right off the bat when you apply.
I have a friend that's a professor and a head of a department there, and he said that's the biggest bogus thing they spread out and tell everybody. It's very easy when you're in that school to change your major.
It's once you're there.
Like 2 weeks ago.
I attended Cal Poly and I changed schools because I could not change majors.
Right.
So they make you basically take double loads in two majors to be even start the process. Then you have to meet certain requirements. It's increasing. It's very challenging to change majors. The one thing, last thing that sparked my memory about is if you're looking at specific majors and thinking about doing undeclared, double check what you think you might want to transfer into. For example, San Diego State, this is something new that they splashed on this last year, and it kind of screwed up one of our students because neither of us knew about this until later. Is, for example, this person wanted to go into a nursing program. They that fall announced that they will no longer allow you to transfer into a nursing program. This person was going in undeclared, and then they changed it to where you could not transfer undeclared. So we couldn't even actually get her in this nursing program because they changed this and we were not aware. So double check if you have something, if you're going to do undeclared, just know what you might want to go into and see if there's any requirements that are going to restrict you from doing that. Nursing will probably be the biggest one that would probably do that, but there might be other programs as well. Any other questions? Any questions?
I'm kind of answering some basic things here that I know how to do this again. But they would like, meetings with us.
Okay,
so put some information.
If there's no other questions, that's it, guys. Go get some dinner.
All right.